this video from the Still Life Lighting mini-series, we'll discuss the camera depth of field and its properties, the anamorphic aspect ratio for that cinematic zing, and we'll segue into Blender's material properties such as subsurface scattering to find that sparkling synergy between materials and lighting we're trying to establish. Now allow me to digress and talk about the depth of field and anamorphic lenses. For me, the way the light gets distorted and scattered while passing through our virtual lens is an integral part of the whole lighting setup, and it's definitely an important part of our cinematography. So let's get into the camera settings while having the camera selected and activate the depth of field. Right away, we can see that our camera focused on a certain point, and we can shift this point with the help of the distance slider. It works just like the focus ring on the lens. It works in a really physically plausible way because that's a path tracing render engine. And to not guess the distance, it's always easier to have a focus object somewhere in the scene, like this empty object here. The easy way to place one is to shift and right click to place a 3D cursor somewhere, then shift A and spawn an empty object. But I'll get rid of it because we already have one. Let's use it. It's called focus, so I'm clicking on the camera border to select it. Then down within the depth of field settings, I'm clicking on the eyedropper and selecting our focus empty. As for the lens aperture settings, we have the f-stop parameter that controls how closed or open is our aperture. The higher values produce the extended depth of field, very wide depth of field, and on the contrary, the lower values like 2.8 or even lower like 1.4 produce a very narrow depth of field, where a tiny portion of 3D depth is in focus and everything else is devoured by a creamy bokeh. We can fine-tune the bokeh shape by adjusting the number of the aperture blades. We'll see the effect in just a moment. And also adjusting the anamorphic ratio, where 1 is a perfectly spherical lens and 2 is a lens with an anamorphic squeeze. I'm gonna go with 1.6 for a balanced, slightly anamorphic look. The way that the anamorphic lenses work, aside from squeezing the out-of-focus elements, is that it leads to a widescreen aspect ratio, like 2.5 to 1, like 1920 by 816 pixels. Let's run a quick comparison now. Here is a perfectly spherical lens with the aperture ratio of 0 and the 8 blades aperture. Here we've bumped the aperture ratio to 2, meaning an anamorphic lens. It's still got a retro 8 blades aperture look. If it's an anamorphic lens, it should probably have a widescreen aspect ratio, you know, to keep it historically accurate. And this pairing of the lens and the aspect ratio just looks cinematic. And finally, it should probably feature an anamorphic flare, but we won't go that direction yet. Now going back to our cinematic lighting formula to fill in an important gap, the fill light and how it helps to set a contrast ratio. So far, the only fill light in our scene was the bounce from our main light. If we wanted to reduce the overall contrast and fill in the shadows ever so slightly, we could go into the environment settings and boost the environment light strength. The fill lights are usually placed at the complementary angle to the key light to change the contrast of the lighting, but here we can get away with the omnidirectional environment light. And I would also warm up its tone, because I imagine this room to be of warmer color due to the sunlight reflected, and also implying the additional bounce from the table. In this case, a solid color for the environment is more than enough to control the fill, but if we wanted to make it fancier, we could have used one of the environments, let's say from Polyhaven, which I love. You can choose from many different 360 degrees spherical high dynamic range panoramas, all of them are free, and we will definitely explore this more sophisticated way of controlling the ambient light, among other things, in the next chapter. So that again was a teaser. Alright, when the key light was our only light source, some part of the scene simply didn't receive any exposure. After adding the fill light though, these underexposed shadowy areas can be, well, filled in, and that is essentially how we control the light versus dark contrast. keeping the fill light pretty low leads to a dramatic change in exposure between lit and shaded parts. Something like 10 to 1 or 15 to 1. Such dramatic contrast between key and fill is called low-key lighting. On the other end of the spectrum, the fill light can become so strong that it can virtually eliminate all the shadows, or at least achieve much lower contrast ratios, something like 2 to 1. That's called the high-key lighting. So ultimately, it is all about increasing or decreasing the contrast ratio for the chiaroscuro contrasty look, or on the other hand, for the high-key low contrast look, or any number of stops in between. You decide. My take on the balance between key and fill in this case is to aim for a medium contrast, maybe leaning towards the dramatic side of the spectrum, slightly towards low-key look. And now it's time for a quick digression. From my experience and the way I work, in every lighting project there comes a point when the basic light scheme is pretty much nailed for the most part, and you know it's good, and you are satisfied with it. Everything works together just fine. From there, it makes sense to change the perspective and give some love to materials before getting down to the lighting details. Materials in computer graphics dictate the way the light rays bounce off or travel through surfaces, and the influence of shaders on the overall look cannot be overestimated, so in this off-topic subplot, I guess we can try enhancing our materials with the subsurface light transport effect, and spend a few minutes casually talking about material properties in general. So we have strategically placed our key light behind the subject. Now what if we allowed some part of this light to actually penetrate the translucent surface of this object and exit at some different point? I'm talking about the subsurface scattering effect, or subsurface light transport as it's called sometimes. As we have mentioned already, by default this effect was disabled in our demo scene. What we can do now is strike it back on by reconnecting the loose dot that you can find in the shader editor back into the subsurface scattering slot. Doing that will open the way for some really intriguing lighting calculations. What we need to do is select our main mineral and open the shader editor in the top window. You can press Shift F3 if you want to do it via shortcut. There you will find our principal BSDF shader with a subsurface socket and the loose dot that needs to be dragged onto this socket. Subsurface scattering simulates semi-translucent objects in which light rays enter, bounce around, then exit in a different place. Aside from the subsurface slider that controls the amount of the effect, there is the subsurface radius drop-down menu where you can control the coloring or the tint of the effect. There are three channels there, red, green and blue, and you can tweak each one separately. For example, you can tweak the red one to increase or decrease the amount of red light scattered around. So yeah, basically that's how you give this mineral a sapphire, ruby or whatever else tint. Aside from the subsurface radius, there is one more parameter that allows us to tint the subsurface scattering effect, which is subsurface color, but I find it slightly hard to achieve really saturated colors, it's a little bit unpredictable, so that's why I resorted to use the subsurface radius instead. Now let's quickly explore the nodes that would go into the subsurface slot. I'm going to control shift to preview this node alone. And basically there is the color ramp that receives the original diffuse texture, then makes it black and white and adjusts the contrast of it. The brighter the color, the more scattering and vice versa. Now control shift back onto the principled BSDF. Okay, so it's a mechanism of tweaking the variable subsurface scattering. Then we should just grab the loose dot and hook it up into the subsurface input, and we should be good to go. The contrast can be tweaked by moving the flags closer to each other within the color ramp node, and the power of the effect can be tweaked by adjusting the tone or the value of these flags. For example, by making it darker, you will reduce the amount of scattering. So, one mineral done, a few more to go. I will go through every object one by one really quickly, except the table. So let's select this stone in the background, click on the dot and connect it to the subsurface input. Now do the same with this one. And the one in the foreground has no subsurface scattering, so no need to touch it. Here's how it looked before. And after subsurface scattering applied. Once again, the position of our main light complements the subsurface scattering effect so much, because not only the shadows fall in the direction of the camera, and the reflections go in that direction as well, but the light scattered through the stone also exits in the direction of the camera, if that makes sense. And it all clicks because of the position of the key light in the reverse key manner. Cool, right? Now, while we are reviewing our materials, let's go through other properties of our principal BSDF shader, just in case. What else do we have here that can be controlled? We have the specular slider that controls the amount of reflections. That can play a major role in how the object would look under certain lighting conditions. How many glossy rays in cycles does it reflect? That could be important. And the other really crucial thing is how glossy is it, or how diffuse is it on the other end of the spectrum. We have yet another color ramp here for controlling the glossiness or roughness, which is the same thing but inverted. You can play with the position of the flags to make the certain portions of the object look wet, for example. Let's disconnect this texture from the roughness input for a second. So basically, the low roughness means that the object is super glossy, surprise, and the higher roughness brings it closer to the perfect diffuse look. With the color ramp implemented, we achieve a so-called variable roughness, meaning that the certain portions of the object reflect the light in a more glossy manner, while the other are way more dull. The details like that may not seem like a big deal, but what is lighting in 3D if it's not interactions between the emissive surfaces and the materials, basically? So here comes the variable roughness color ramp. Control shift to preview. Dark means glossy or even mirror-like if it's black. Bright means rough and diffuse. And then control the contrast via the flags within the color ramp. Okay, shift click on the main material. What else do we have here? The object can be metallic if the metallic slider is pushed all the way to the right. Or it can be a perfect dielectric material if the slider is set to zero. Lastly, if you feel like turning this object into a diamond, feel free to experiment with the transmission slider that controls the object translucency, how much light passes through the object. It works similar to subsurface scattering, but in a slightly different manner. It doesn't necessarily scatter the light around. It lets the light pass through, just like glass. As they say, not everything is made of clay, and transmission shows just that. The transmission roughness controls how clear is the object transparency. At the higher values, it can make the interior or volume portion of the mesh seem murky. So that's what it does. Aside from that, there is a good old albedo texture or a diffuse texture at play that adds the base color to the object. Control shift click to preview it really quickly. Yeah, there is the base color of the object that affects, among the other things, how much light bounces off that object. So there was a quick rundown of the properties of the mineral shader, principled BSDF, that can be tweaked alongside the subsurface scattering. I tried to keep the material fairly generic and fairly well balanced for the tutorial, though. It has a little bit of everything. It's neither super glossy nor super rough. It has some subsurface scattering, it has some color, but not overwhelming amount of saturation in it. So that was a quick digression to bring the material and lighting interaction to the foreground for a second. That is important for 3D lighting. Now, with that in mind, and with the added beauty of subsurface scattering, letting some light bounce around the object, let us return to our cinematic lighting setup and keep upgrading it. That was a quick detour into material properties that are also an important part of the look we may be going for with our lighting. And in the next video, we'll put the finishing touches, such as special effects like cinematic haze, dust, and lens flares.